بشرا مثلكم إنكم إذا لخاسرون.
If you are going to follow a human being just like you, then you will be losers. Look at how foolish the statement is. Now there is something important in this story of Ad. They debated a lot with Hud alayhi salam. And also, they always went back to their cronies and their people, and they began to tell them, look, we told him this, we said that, and he doesn't have an answer. Not that he doesn't have an answer. Common sense is an answer. You know what else they said?
أَيَعِدُكُمْ أَنَّكُمْ إِذَا مِتُّمْ وَكُنْتُمْ تُرَابًا وَعِظَامًا أَنَّكُمْ مُخْرَجُونَ هيهات هيهات لما توعدون.
Is he promising you that when you die and you have become decomposed, that you are then going to be resurrected? Far, very far is that which you are being promised. It cannot be a reality. Imagine. They are saying, how can he tell you that when you go down and you're going to be decomposed, that you're going to come up? My beloved brothers and sisters, the lesson I learn and you learn from this. Sometimes we claim and we know, we believe that we are going to be resurrected, but the way we operate in our lives, as though there's no day of judgment. The way we carry on with all our bad ways, we never bat an eyelid sometimes. We never sit back to think, but I'm drinking, I'm clubbing, I'm committing adultery, I've got all these bad habits, and at the same time, I'm claiming that there's a life after death. How on earth can that happen? So sometimes we join the ranks of these people without knowing. But then Allah has mercy upon us. He sends to us the month of Ramadan. He sends to us blessed days. He gives us a Jumu'ah. It is compulsory for you to attend and try and listen to the message. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because the message will be uttered to soften the hearts. To soften the hearts. So whenever we read these stories, let's not just think that those people, they said, how will we be resurrected? We believe in resurrection, but sometimes our lives are proving otherwise. The way we lead them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about what else they said.
إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ.
They told each other, look, this is just a life, enjoy it as much as you can. We are alive and we will die and that's it, there's no resurrection.
إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا رَجُلٌ بِهِ جِنَّةٌ.
Same accusation as those who accused the Prophet Noah, may peace be upon him. They said, this man has a jinnah. Has a jinnah. What is the meaning of a jinnah? Jinn. He is possessed. So don't listen to him. Another verse, do you know what they said?
إن نقول إلا اعتراك بعض آلهتنا بسوء.
We are not uttering anything except that some of our gods have caused this man to become mad. Because he's gone against our gods, so the gods have become angry with him, these stones have become upset with him, and therefore they have inflicted him with a mental disease, and now he's a mental case. That's what they're saying. Why were all these statements? Let me tell you why. Because these rich, wealthy people who had lots, who were big, huge, no sickness. They were massive people. They used to dwell in huge dwellings. We're going to get to the type of dwellings they had. They were scared that we are going to have to change our whole lifestyle because one man is telling us something. So rather than changing their lifestyle and securing the akhirah, they decided to secure the dunya and lose the akhirah. Now with us, sometimes we are sitting comfortable in our bad habits and so many things, and there comes a man and he starts reminding us, leave your drinking, leave your drugs, leave your gambling, leave your this, leave your womanizing, leave your bad habits, leave your lying, your cheating, your hatred, your deception, your so on and so on and so forth. And then we become upset. People who eat interest, you find a man saying, leave your interest, and they say, no, block that man, stop that man, kick him out, throw him away. Well, to be honest, that's exactly what they did in all the previous nations, and Allah gave them respite up to a certain time. After that, destruction was total. So we must not become upset when someone touches the button. No, we must be happy. What is meant by touching the button? Exactly what's wrong with us, they're mentioning it. Don't say this man is attacking me or attacking this one. Nobody is attacking anyone. We need to realize it is Allah's message, just like all the others. The messengers were sent, they were direct, as we said. So now they started saying this man is a madman, and this man is like this, and he is possessed, only so that the others would not listen to him. Because if 1, 2, 5, 10, 20, 50 people started listening, he would start getting a base and he would be able to attack. He would be able to become victorious over these. No. So what did they decide to do? Allah speaks about them in the Quran. Allah says, وَإِذَا بَطَشْتُمْ بَطَشْتُمْ جَبَّارِينَ فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُونَ. Hud alayhi salam told them that when you seize, when you want to punish someone, you destroy them totally. You seize so powerfully as though you are tyrants. A jabbar is a person who's killed a few people. He's known as a jabbar. Someone who's killed more than one or someone who's killed more than two is known as a jabbar. Which means they used to kill off those who were weak and those who tried to go towards the message. They used to kill off those whom they considered a threat. Nobody could tell them anything. Why? They were huge, powerful people. And they were in the majority. Allahu Akbar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned them through the Prophet Hud. But now I want to spend a few moments describing to you their houses. Allah says, أَتَبْنُونَ بِكُلِّ رِيعٍ آيَةً تَعْبَثُونَ وَتَتَّخِذُونَ مَصَانِعَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَخْلُدُونَ. Are you those who used to build on the mountains, on every high place, you had your monumental home and palace? What is a monumental home and palace? They built palaces on top of the mountains, huge palaces which they did not live in. It was only known that mountains, that house is for this man, that house is for that man, that house is for this man. Those were all on sand dunes and on the little mounts that they had. They were not living in them. So Allah says, are you building extravagantly these homes that you're not living in, you're not going to stay in them, and you becoming so indulged that you're forgetting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allahu Akbar. And on top of that, the next verse says, and then in the valleys, you build the little houses that you are going to live in such a manner that you think you're going to live forever. وَتَتَّخِذُونَ مَصَانِعَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَخْلُدُونَ. You have taken these fine homes for yourselves as though you are going to live forever. Allahu Akbar. So imagine the houses. These people, they owned the mountains. They carved up at the top of the mountains a place for them to live. And not for them to live, in fact, for them to boast, to brag. That's my home. That one's my house. That one's the other one's house. That's the uncle's house. And so on. Allahu Akbar. Look, my beloved brothers and sisters. There is nothing wrong with owning a lot. There is nothing wrong with being wealthy. But the lesson is, the wealthier we become, the more down to earth we should be. The more we should be found in the masjid. The more we should be found giving charities. Subhanallah. That is when we will save ourselves from torment and from pain. And the lesson is for the rest as well. When you don't have much, there is a greater likelihood that you will be saved. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us savior. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us content with what we have. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about their size. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَاذْكُرُوا إِذْ جَعَلَكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ مِنْ بَعْدِ قَوْمِ نُوحٍ وَزَادَكُمْ فِي الْخَلْقِ بَسْطَةً.
Remember, Hud alayhi salam is telling his people, remember that Allah has made you the successors of the people of Noah. Allah has made you the successors of the people of Noah, may peace be upon him, who were destroyed completely. You are the successors, and Allah has given you greater physical strength than them. So fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they started spreading a rumor that this man here, he's doing it for some ulterior motive. He wants some money. And this happened all the time. When someone came with goodness, and related the message. They said, this guy must be making a lot of money out of this, that's why he's there. Allahu Akbar. Why? Why lay accusations? So Hud alayhi salatu wasalam says,
يا قومي لا أسألكم عليه أجرا إن أجري إلا على الذي فطرني أفلا تعقلون.
Oh my people, I'm not asking you to recompense me in any way whatsoever. My reward lies with the one who made me. Notice he didn't say على الله. He didn't say my reward is with Allah. He says my reward is with the one who made me. Because he was calling his people to worshipping the one who made them, who is Allah. But when you use the term my maker, nobody has an answer. Worship your maker, worship your creator, worship the one you are going to return to. What do we call him? We call him the worshipped one, translated in Arabic as Allah from Aliha Ya'la. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So sometimes when you use the word Allah, people think you're referring to a human, you're referring to an idol. I read an article once, not very long time ago, where people were trying to spread this rumor that Allah is actually, na'udhu billah, one idol that was remaining in the Kaaba at the time, and they call him Allah, and that's who the Muslims believe in, and that's why they prostrate to the Kaaba. No, we don't. We do not worship the black box at all, not at all. The only reason why we face that direction is to create uniformity. Allah decided that this is where you will face. And the Quran says, virtue and righteousness is not achieved by which direction you face, whether you face the east or the west. It's a verse in the Quran. But if you believe in Allah, then you've arrived. Then you have achieved righteousness. And so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So remember, there are people who intentionally try to misguide others. We should be careful, and we should also convey the message to as many people as possible. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this Nabi, great Nabi, who was being tortured as well. He was being sworn at. He was being told so many things. One of the things he was told, he says, he was told that our forefathers did not come with what you have come with. So why should we listen to you? How can you go against your forefathers? Same thing.
قالوا أجئتنا لنعبد الله وحده ونذر ما كان يعبد آباؤنا.
Are you telling us to worship one Allah and to leave these things that our forefathers used to worship? What lesson do we have in that? My beloved brothers and sisters, we've said it and we will repeat it. This is why Allah has repeated it in the Quran. Whatever we are doing, if it is right, alhamdulillah. If it is wrong, no matter how many generations of our forefathers have been doing it, it will be wrong. So we should know, when the truth comes to us, even if generations before us have been indulged in wrong, we should surrender to the truth. We will be securing our akhirah. Like Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam told his father, he says, oh my father, knowledge has come to me which hasn't come to you, so follow me, I will guide you. Allahu Akbar. His father was too arrogant. He says, no, I'm not. Firstly, I'm making money from these idols. And secondly, who do you think you are? You're my son. How can you tell that to me? Allahu Akbar. Sometimes our children will go far beyond us in religion and in studies. They will come and they will tell us, dad, you're wrong. Mom, why don't you cover your hair? Do you know that that hair continues cursing you for as long as it is open in public? My beloved mother, cover it. This is the day of Ramadan. Make a decision for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the mother says, hey, how can you talk to your mom like that? What is that? That is rejection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The poor son is coming, he's learnt a lot more. And he is coming to now obey the commands of Allah and to teach others the same commands. How can we reject it? This is why we always say that whenever your children have shown greater spirituality and they move further than you, encourage them. That will be a point of your encouragement as well. I have seen cases where the mother is semi-naked and the daughter is in full hijab. MashaAllah. Now if we are going to be feeling, what word can we use? If we are going to be feeling bad or embarrassed, that's the word, embarrassed to walk with our own daughter somewhere just because she's dressed appropriately, or walk with your son who's got a huge beard, MashaAllah, in the streets of New York, why should we be embarrassed? That's our child. That's our son. If Allah has given them the courage to do that, alhamdulillah. If Allah has given them the courage greater than us, why must we pull them down to our level? Try and get up to their level. And if you haven't had